وعليه الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين سيما بقية الله الأعظم بقية الله خير لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين ولعنة الدائم على أعدائهم وغاصب حقوقهم ومنكري فضائلهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد ولله الأسماء الحسنى فادعوا بها صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات على محمد وعلى محمد We've been looking at the phenomena of brotherhood in the plain of Karbala. But like we said, to understand the reality of brotherhood, أخوات إنما المؤمنون إخوة, the verse which we kind of looked into a bit detail last night, or certain riwayat and traditions that we paid attention to. Inshallah, tonight as well, we plan to look at a bit more concrete examples or commendations of our masumeen in regards to this phenomena of brotherhood. However, as we are looking this reality onto a deeper level, we investigated the whole procedure or the process, how this phenomena is investigated, after which we pointed out that this phenomena manifests itself in a form of a divine reality, in a form of an immaterial reality, into that intermediary world, in a form of brotherhood. At the same time, there are other realities dwelling in that intermediary realm as well. For instance, we pointed out to Nizafat with an example last night, that Nizafat is also, you know, min al iman, is from that, or iman itself, for example. So all of these intermediary realities which are immaterial, iman, Islam, hijrat, all of these things we kind of briefly looked, they are in this intermediary realm, and they manifest into this mode, into this time and space, that the time and space that we exist. If you may recall, we had mentioned that we will look at the practical way of recollecting or come to understanding of this reality as we live in this world. One of the things that we said is that, you know, paying attention on, you know, what's going on, the ownership, so on and so forth, and we got to carry down. But still, it's thought-provoking, it's exciting, but there has to be a method by which we could control our this wild horse, this sort of thoughts and imaginations that we have, and we kind of, you know, take different routes while we are trying to concentrate on this niyat that, okay, if you begin your work with the niyat of, you know, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is sawab for you, yes. And then we went on a deeper level, you know, in regards to the hidayat, in regards to what's, you know, the chemistry between me and my work and my colleagues, brotherhood, so on, well and good. But there has to be something more concrete by which we could fall on that and then see whether we are excelling in the right direction or not. If we are excelling, if we are moving in the right direction to understand this divine reality, then what is expected from this progress that we are having, what we will see. In the methodology of Allama and in other places as well, once again, when we are saying methodology of Allama Tabata, it means that it is based upon that very Quran and Sunnah. It is nothing outside that. Which we pointed out to that when a person moves away from this materiality, he pays attention to this spirituality, well and good. Then he comes and points out to the importance of watchfulness, which is the term used by the scholars of the path as muraqibah, being on a constant watch of every action that a person is carrying it out. It's the foundation of this journey, without which, you know, you could denominate all of the things that we have discussed in regards to moving away from that materiality, so on and so forth. It's a constant checks and balances, so to speak, that he will carry it out by this constant watch, which they term it as muraqabah, which they term it as being watchfulness. Let's see what, you know, this risala have been translated in English as well, under the title of Colonel of the Colonel, and you could find that online as well. Let's see how they kind of depict or describe what is the deeper meaning of that, even in terms of the poetry. You know, for example, when the poets talked about, you know, پیشتر از خلقت انگورها خورده میرا و نمود شورها, you know, Rumi, before the creation of the grapes itself, drank the may, which is drank the, you know, the drink which comes from the angur. Khod may is the literal translation would be sharab, but this sharab, this drink, is that divine symbolic action which is muraqabah itself, people have said. So meaning that, for example, in another shayr, you know, Allama discusses this, be peer maykade guftam ke cheez raaye nijat. Peer maykade is the master of maykada, is a place where they drink alcohol, the tavern, you know, the pub or the tavern, you know, if you want to call. Be peer maykade guftam ke cheez raaye nijat. You know, the peer is like, even in Urdu is a peer, you know, like murshid is like murshid, you know, the head of that. They say, what is the raaye nijat? What is that path that will save? Be khaste jam may guft raaz pushidan. Be khaste jam may wa guft raaz pushidan. Raaye khalwat ge khasam be numa ta pas as in may khordam ba to wa digar gham dunya nakhoram. So basically, it's this may, this drink, which exists even in the poetry of Imam Khomeini, you would find that. They say that this may is really considered as muraqibah. It's considered as being watchfulness. So now here, before the pishtar as khilqate angura khorde may rawa namood shorha, even before the creation of the grapes, meaning that he has been constantly carrying out that action which is muraqibah, which is being watchful, and numud shura means he lost it, meaning that he has entered that realm of unity, that realm of passion, that realm of love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has become majnoon. So by carrying out that action which is being watchful, which is a may, which is like symbolized as a drink, and that is which is the raaye nijat as well, that is the path, you know, may is that raaye nijat, you know, if one have that, he will forget sort of what the poetry is saying about the dunya, you know, what's happening or whatsoever in there, so on and so forth. So therefore, you know, when a person drinks that may, meaning that when he becomes watchful, then he will enter that realm of love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he will start seeing the reality. So muraqibah, so being watchfulness, is that one have to be constantly on guard of every little action that he is carrying it out. You know, he has to be awake. He has to have, then when he is carrying this out, then it says automatically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will unveil himself. Unveil that light, that noor. Wa ashraqatil ardu bi noor absaraha. You know, that light will be seen. And this, the scholars of the path, you know, I'm just trying to translate and inform the brothers and sisters who are paying attention, who are here and are coming every night, is they say that it could last for a second. It could last for a minute. It could last for 10 minutes. Or eventually it will become a constant part of his. this seeing of these divine lights, seeing of that divine reality. And the possibility of it, as they have said, for example, is while reciting Quran, it could take place. When a person is reciting Quran, all of a sudden he would see that light, or he would see himself reciting the Quran. Because that action is an action where Allah is unveiling himself. It's symbolic, it's very symbolic here. Where Allah is unveiling himself to the abd, to the slave. You know, that's what we say, right? In the conventional sense, or for our common understanding, you know, namaz is that you are speaking to Allah. Quran is that when Allah is speaking to you. So if you go on this, I mean, it's so beautifully interwoven. Things are, the traditions are, the verses are, it's deeper level on every meaning what the masumeen, what the awliya say. When they say shaitan-e-buzurg, it's something there, very deep. But it's a very simple meaning as well at the same time. That's how awliya are. So therefore, if a person says that when someone is reciting Quran, it is Allah revealing, it's like having wahi taking place in his heart. The hadith says when you recite Quran, it is like you are Nabi but without Mursal. You're not a Mursal Nabi. You're not like a messenger. But it's like wahi. But if a person reaches to that high level of spirituality, obviously it's like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unveiling you, is showing his beauty. That is kalam of Allah, which is hay, the Quran, which is not like a book of history, no. It is hay, it is alive, it is from hayyul ladhi la yamut. And there's a beautiful letter which says that when they will enter paradise, that when they will enter that realm of baqa, a letter will come from hayyul ladhi la yamut to hayyul ladhi la yamut. From a person, from the being which is eternal, to another being which is eternal. So one of the halat they say is that. However, it could be at the same time any state that the person is engaging himself with that understanding and with that deeper understanding. I'd mentioned this earlier as well, where there was this Banu Mushtahida of Isfahan. She was Mushtahida. And Allama visits her to discuss issues in regards to Mizan, about Tafsir. I mean, she was very deep in terms of her knowledge. And it's been said that while she was brooming the house, while she was busy in the house doing work, that was the hour when she entered that realm of immateriality. That was the hour then she saw that light, that nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which filled the east and west. So it could be that person who is on constant guard all the time for every action that he is carrying out, it could unveil itself at that hour, unexpectedly. And it is usually the case is unexpectedly, because if I'm intending, okay, I want to see this and I want to see that, still you have that eye there. And the other aspect that we tend to find, which is very symbolic in regards to the night prayers, the night vigils, these are all tools and means for us to release ourselves. You know, night prayers, shariat, all the ahkam that is there is to release ourselves. One of them, and the greatest one, this is a night prayer. In that, they have prescribed us that we recite Surah Sajda, Surah Saad. While a person recites that, there's an ayah which have the Sajda Wajib. So while doing that, he has to fall in the Sajda. So this is once again symbolic. When does a person will fall in Sajda? When he sees that Jamal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hikmat, the mystery perhaps, the hidden mystery behind that is that when he sees that, he has no other choice but to fall in the Sajda and show his, you know, need, show that how low he is in front of that great Jamal, in front of that great beauty that he has seen. An incident that is also reported in regards to the Prophet, that he was in the house of Bibi Fatima Zahra Salamullah Alayha. And as he was there, and all of a sudden he went in the sajda. And the daughter inquires that, "Oh Prophet, what happened? And we haven't seen you carrying out this action." Then the Prophet replied after the sajda that Allah showed me the manzil and the maqam of Imam Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. And when I saw that status, I fall into the sajda. So that once again is that manifestation of that divine mercy which have taken in a form of a waliullah, whatever that level of qurb may be. Now this sajda we could interpret as a sajda of thanksgiving, but this sajda could also be interpreted as that manifestation of that jamal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what was seen, forced the Prophet to fall into the sajda. Because when a person sees those beauties, you know, the jamal, the beauty of God, it's automatic. You know, it's a reaction that's what will take place. It's a completion of fulfillment. It's a completion of that proximity, that nearness that have taken place, reflected in the worldly plane. See, sajda, once again, the beauty of the hadith of Ahlul Bayt is so that on every level it could be interpreted. What is sajda? They ask, what is the manzil, closest manzil of insan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So now, if the imam would have said, oh, the closest manzil is this anwar, manifestation as we are speaking, and most of us are not understanding what we are speaking. The imam replied that the closest manzil, the closest place is when a person is in sajda. That's the nazdik tareen maqam bande ba khudaan mutal ke waqti ke sajde. Now that nearness which have taken place in that spiritual realm have to reflect in this world. And that will be nothing but sajda. So physically he is in sajda, but spiritually he is somewhere else. Spiritually he's witnessing that jamal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is near that immaterial realm that he is dwelling in. That is why we have seen, or some of the translation that we have recited, where they say they see themselves. You know, one of the steps of realization of that is tajarrud, is that he comes out of his own body, where he see himself sleeping in bed, but at the same time he's outside. This could be at a time of sleep. This could be at a time of, you know, for example, as people have recorded. But people who are weak, perhaps, because that is the time and hour of contemplation, that is a time of where naturally the spirits, part of the spirits leave the body. So the possibility to take place, that experience is at that hour. So now, when we look at other traditions, which is particularly in regards to that, and even witnessing other being and other creatures. If you help me with the salawat, this was very interesting. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. This was a very interesting story which was mentioned by Allama in this book, that we find Haj Imam Quliye Nakhjawani. کہ استاد معارف مرحوم آقای سید حسن آقای قاضی, who was the father of مرزا علی قاضی, the father of سید علی قاضی طباطبائی, who was the teacher of علامہ طباطبائی, so his father. He was near آقا سید خریش خزوینی, and he was one of the near, meaning that he was one of the students, and he quotes that he saw Shaitan and himself, and he was an old man, this person. And he saw Shaitan and himself. This himself is that old man who was the Ustad of Akhlaq of Allama, father, you know, the father of Sayyid Ali Qazi. And he saw Shaitan there, and he says to Shaitan, while pointing out to his Mahasin, "I'm an old man, you know, spare me." Then Shaitan looks at him and says, "Do you see this?" Because they were on this peak, on this elevation, on this mountain. you see that this mountain, and this you see, look down there, you know, it's like a big ditch, dark, like it's like pit of hellfire, so to speak. If you are ghafil for a second, that's your place. I will spare no one. I will spare no one. Shaitan have given the oath, have promised God that he will sit. And if one pays attention to those verses of the Quran in Surah Araf, where he talks about, I'll come from the right, I'll come from the left, I'll come from the front and from behind. I will not spare, give a moment for insan, but I will deviate them. And the fifth Imam have a deeper explanation, what does it mean by the right, by the left, by the front. But anyway, but illa, except those who are the sincere ones, mukhlaseen, they cannot be deviated. So this journey of ours, as we had mentioned mukhlaseen and mukhlaseen earlier in our previous discussion, this journey of ours is going in that direction, that we become those righteous ones. And it's not a simple journey. It's not easy. You know, it's hard work. And it's got to be hard work. And if we do not at least familiarize ourselves with these things that exist in our deen, in our religion, in our school of thought, then we are really ghafil. At least this, through this barakat of Azadari wa Imam Hussain, we are familiarizing ourselves that such a thing is possible and such a thing exists. And at the same time, we are trying to perhaps look at certain ways, such as we said, one of the practical way is that being watchful, that muraqibah, which is the foundation of it. And Allama Tabatabai mentions here that during the day, when I am strong in my muraqibah, when I am strong in being watchful, the unveiling that I have at night is much clearer. So the stronger I am in terms of my action during the day, that I am always constantly being watchful of my action, that I am carrying it out. Why? For what reason? And what is the hidden relationship behind, which we discuss, you know, intellectually speaking or philosophically speaking. I'm trying to extract that out. So if I'm constantly on guard and watching that, eventually when I am in a state where I have surrendered myself physically, for example, in a state of a sleep to begin with, then Allah will open Himself. That is why we tend to find that dreams are the first means or first ways where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends His wahi, sends His messages. And then after that, gradually it improves. So, establishing another fact, which we had mentioned earlier, perhaps in the second session that we have there, that really sleep is a way of increasing of our conscious. When a person is asleep, rather than him being unconscious, which is on that physical reality, but the beauty of Islam is always that it works in the opposites. Through the sacrifice, through the defeat of Imam Hussein with Yazid, that was really a victory. That's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, works in His mysterious ways. A people who is not a Muslim, when the story of Karbala is mentioned, without what happened afterwards and all that, obviously you would say that, okay, two people fighting, one who dies, he is dead, the one who is victorious, you know, he is alive, he is victorious. But the truth is that no, Hussein, Yazid died, but Imam Hussein is still alive. So therefore, when a person is unconscious, when, for instance, Musa wanted to see the manifestation of God, he goes into that sa'iqa, that sound, that tajalli, that manifestation, on that Jabal, made Musa unconscious, but other people died. So when Musa was unconscious, he was constantly, his understanding was increasing in regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The emanation was continuing. It wasn't that when he's unconscious, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not manifest on that Jabal. But it happened and that led to that. So when we said earlier, this physical eye doesn't really see. This physical eye is also not for seeing. Because Allah says, don't see that. When we don't see that, then Allah will show something else. So therefore, when a person sleeps, when a person goes into a state of unconsciousness, then to begin with, that is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts unveiling the emanations of God is shown to him. So it's really, if one sits and concentrates and looks at the traditions, one would to come to the understanding of that. Why is it mentioned in regards to Hazrat Amir that if you want to see a dead person walking, look at Amirul Mumineen? So that means, however he is dealing with things, he is speaking to people, doing everything, but at the same time he is pronounced dead by the Prophet. That means in terms of his desire, in terms of his nafs, nothing exists. All that activity that is taking place is nothing but that divine activity, but nothing that divine manifestations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Recite one salat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. In this very fact, you also find, because they are darajat, because they are levels. In this very fact, you find a story from Baba Farajullahi Madzub, a person who was known as an Arif. They asked him, you know, in which it says that they asked him, as yeki az madzubin ke be name Baba Farajullahi Madzub bud, جذب الهی دامنگیر شده بود سوال کردن که دنیا را برای ما توصیف کن. He was attracted to these divine lights and he was annihilated in these divine lights. They asked him, you know, explain me the world. Give me توصیف of this dunya. In reply, از آن وقت که من چشم گشودم دنیا را ندیدم تا کنون برای شما توصیف کنم. Since that time I have opened my eyes, I haven't seen the world where I could explain what the world is. This is another level where a person doesn't see the dunya at all, but at the same time there are certain people who are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the same time they are in this world as well. Those are the kummalul awliya, those are the most perfect ones. So what this is pointing in what direction? It's a journey. And it has to come in our, you know, lifetime. At least it has to start in our lifetime to begin with. And we go in that direction. When we go in that direction, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He Himself is the one who have promised that He will take that step towards us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have said, if you do my zikr, I will do yours. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have promised, when we ask, oh Allah, make my days and night filled with your remembrance. So this day and night filled with the remembrance is not just I sit on the prayer mat and just do zikr all the time. No, this day or night filled with the remembrance is that I sit with my family, train my children, go to work, come back from work, but I be watchful of every action that I am doing. And then when I'm being watchful, this is the practical way which we are discussing here, in order to achieve that, to see that divine image. So if I am being watchful of that, then obviously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will unveil Himself. Then you have other practical prescriptions being described in the traditions, and also advised by our scholars. Those who really want to embark on this path is very much required for them to do so. Now let's pay attention to a couple of traditions in regards to in regards to the reality of brotherhood, because we were just discussing in principles about phenomena and the reality of brotherhood. But we have to really look into the practicality of it. Alhamdulillah, we were blessed to look at few of the hadith and tradition and ayat in regards to what really brotherhood means and how to maintain that and why it has been so much emphasized in our religion. Salat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. If you look at this beautiful hadith, which our Prophet. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. In which our Imam have mentioned that the person who makes friendship on the basis of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person, that person's love becomes purified. Let me read the translation of it for some of our brothers here. برادری کردن به خاطر خدا محبت را خالص می‌گرداند. If a person, as we are here, you know, we are here for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are brothers lillah, for the sake of Allah. So when we are brothers of each other, it has a reaction to it. And that reaction is that love is purified, which we talked about khalis, ikhlas, you know, sincerity, how important, what a key role sincerity plays. So how will I get and how will I gain this sincerity? That is when I make friends or when I make brothers in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am brothers for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This, the reaction of this is that it will provide me with that sincerity. Like we said last night, that when a person makes friendship, like that was the Rasul of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which says, Allah inna wudda al-mu'min min a'dama sabab al-imam. A person, when he loves another mu'min, that is considered to be the greatest sabab, that is considered to be the greatest reason of iman. That is considered to be the greatest reason to achieve iman. So if I want to increase my iman, how will I do it? By loving another brother. So see, it's one little thing, but it's bringing about so many goodness in me. It's bringing iman to me. It's bringing sincerity to me, just by loving each other. And we said this brotherhood also have the element of sisterhood as well. So if they are the friends of each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it purifies that. And that's what we see. I mean, if it requires that reflection. Wasn't that love of the ashab of Imam Hussein khalis to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Abu Abdullah al-Hussein? Wasn't the ashab of Imam Hussein in terms of their iman strong? Because they had that bond of brotherhood with each other. And the basis of that, once again, was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, I mentioned this hadith earlier, on the day of judgment, when they will be raised. And from the grave, as they will be raised, fourth Imam says, they will be asked, go to Jannah bighayri hisab. Take them to Jannah. Then the angels will say that, what do you mean? Because the angels have been there to prescribe, to do every little thing. The hereafter is in the hands of angels. Everything is carried out by angels. So Mizan and Hisab and Sirat, بِغَيْرِ Hisab. Why? Then they will ask him that, why are you going to Jannah بِغَيْرِ Hisab? Because نَيْنُ مُتَحَبُّونَ, to this phrase is there, فِيلَّهِ. You know, we loved each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Allah we loved each other. So that reality, that truth of brotherhood that exists, goes to the level that it becomes ghayri hisab. Why does it become ghayri hisab? Because my love have become khalis in this dunya. Why it has become ghayri hisab? Because my iman have increased. That is why it is ghayri hisab. You know, for people who are of strong iman, for people whose love is strong, there's no need of that balance, there's no need of that hisab to take place. They already enter that. Because that day of judgment, which we are talking there, is equivalent to 50,000 years, as the ayah says. So when this divine reality, which is brotherhood, and the spirit of brotherhood resides in our communities, in brothers and sisters, then it creates and it does its own magic. And this is not like a brotherhood, we are talking about something in history. No, it's hay, it's alive, it's real, and it is right here. However, as it is here, but it is on a very low voltage, so to speak. It's dim. It requires that strong brotherhood amongst each other. So strong, as we have said earlier, that on the Ghadir you recite, when you take a mu'min brother, I will not enter paradise without you come. Here we don't want to wait when the sufra is spread and chilo kebab is there, you know, my brother will come next to me. Imagine going to Jannah. We'll say, I will not enter. When the Jannah is prepared, when the Jannah is ready, and they say, oh, you are the one who will enter this paradise, go. You think I'll wait at the door before, where is my brother, he will join me? So needs that strong relationship. And as a matter of fact, you know, we are living at a time where ta'awun al-birra wa taqwa, the ta'awun is very much required. The helping of each other is required. No one is waliullah. Every person is liable to make mistake. We have to look our mistake in a constructive way. How we will resolve this? Resolving of this is important. Not that ikhtilaf is important. We got to come to a resolution of it. And this is what is called helping each other. Ta'awun al birra wa taqwa. In this birr, in this goodness, we got to help each other. And when we are prepared and ready to help each other here, it will be reflected in barzakh and in qiyamah, on the day of judgment and hereafter as well. So that's what is required. So when I'm approaching this reality of brotherhood from that angle, then obviously I will be focusing on resolving it. I'll be focusing in a constructive way, rather than I'll be affected by the difference of opinion in an emotional fashion, in a sentimental fashion, and I'll just get upset with it.